seen in other courses, which is the cross-section between two particles. And in doing so, I will relate to the scattering amplitude that you can compute to the Feynman diagrams. And then, see how much time I have to tell you other things. So this is the last bit of information that we need to actually compare the theory that you define from Lagrangian to the actual experiment that you actually measure in the laboratory, okay? Or in the sky, depending. So the simplest process you might imagine, which involves non-trivially interactions, are processes where you have, well, at least you need to have two particles, otherwise one particle will be free, two particles which interact. And in general, what happens is that interacting, since in general number of particles is not conserved, you may end up with a more non-trivial state, which involves more particles, maybe different particles, different momentum, and so on. There is this process called the scattering process. You start initial time with two particles and end up in general with n particles in the out state. So if you look at the process in the center of mass frame, then what you have is like a particle in one direction, a particle in the opposite direction. Something happens, they collide, and a particle will come out from the experiment. Typically, the experiment, because this probability is typically small, to enhance the rate of events, what happens is that many particles are collided together. Let's say this is a bunch of particle A, this is a bunch of particle B. They are rushed together, they collide, and because of these collisions, because of interactions, some of these particles will interact non-trivially and produce same particle at different moment or different particle. The same process happens when you have just one particle colliding with materials, for example. Particle goes through material. You can see in the center mass frame is again particle which collide, and then the particle can just change momenta or produce new particles. Depends on the probability for this process to happen, depends on the energy of the particle. Okay? So any propagation of a particle because of interaction can be reconduced on this type of process. Even a particle propagating in space will feed the interaction of other particle, again, could be recast in this language. So imagine that you have a bunch of particles A and B that collide. So the number of particles will come out is an observable of the experiment, right? You can just count how many particles come out, knowing how many particles are in. And in particular, you can specify more conditions. You can specify what is the momentum of each of these particles, what are the quantum numbers of each of these particles, if they are particle, antiparticle, and so on. All this information is, in principle, calculable if you have a Lagrange. So what are the number of scattering events, the number of particles coming out, number of events of scattering, is expected to be what? Well, must be proportional to the number of particles, number density of particles A and B. The more particle of type A, the more particle of type B you put, of course, the more scattering events you're going to have. It must also be proportional. Let's say that you put here a bunch of particles, and this bunch of particles has some total length, LB and LA. It must also be proportional to LA and LB. Because you can think of this as, like, imagine I have, instead of this bunch, I put another bunch which is equal to this, which is the same, again. So the number of events will be the one scattering with the first, plus the one scattering with the second, which means that the total number of events must be proportional to the total length of the bunch. Okay? And same for the first bunch. So it must be proportional to the length of bunch A, the length of bunch B, the density of particle for each bunch, and it must be inversely proportional, no, sorry, it must be proportional to also the cross area of this bunch. So these are three-dimensional. There will be some area here. I call it to the same. This is curly A. Okay? It's the area of this sphinx, because you can repeat the same argument and put another bunch beside the original one, and of course you will have double of the number of events, so it must be proportional to the total area of this bunch. So I said that the number of scattered events must be proportional to all these guys. Proportional means that it must be equal to this times some factor that I call sigma. And this factor basically encodes the dynamics of this scattering, the interactions, the type of particle. You see that the product rho A times is the number of particles per unit volume times the volume, which is LA times the area. This is just the number of particles of type A you put in. So you can rewrite this formula as the number of particles type A. We can add this, this, and this. Same for type B. So it's the number of particles type B over the area times this proportionality factor sigma. Of course, this is the number of scattering events. These are just number of particles type A and B. This is an area. So the proportionality factor indeed is a measures of an area, and it's called cross-section. It's a basically the effective cross-section of the particles see when they scatter. So if you had like big balls, classical balls that you can scatter, that will actually match the size of each ball. If you repeat the calculation with classical balls scattering. Of course, now we have macroscopic particles, which are elementary in principle, so they are zero section, but they have a range of interaction. The range of interaction basically plays the same role as a section of a classical ball, and it basically describes how likely it is that two particles will scatter. What is the effective area that the particle see in another particle because of the range of interaction and the strength of interaction. The larger this area, the more probable, the more scattering events you have, the more probable it is that two particles will scatter. So you measure the strength of interaction. Any questions? Clear so far? So if you focus on a particular particle inside the first bunch, then you can also write the number of scattering events per particle of type A, which means that instead of putting a bunch here, I can just consider one particle scattering over a bunch of particles. So the number of scattering events that will come out from this process from here will just be the number of particles B over the area of the section of B times this cross section. But the number of particles B per area is nothing else than the density of particle per unit area, let me call it small n B, times the cross section. Okay, this is the formula we will be using later.
If we have only one particle of type B, then how will this make sense of the area of A?
We will see. Okay. Then, now we have to, we eventually want to compute sigma. If you have sigma, then you can actually compute what is, predict what is the number of scattering events, because you can invert this formula, basically compute the number of scattering events, knowing sigma, knowing how many particle type A and B are, and how they are distributed in space. Reversely, you can just measure how many scattering events, you get an information about sigma. As we will see, sigma will be correlated with our Lagrangian. Okay, so what is the initial state of the problem? So let's build the initial state. Let me consider the general one particle state psi as described by a one particle state with momentum p. I'm not specifying what type of particle, I don't care for the moment. And then I take a wave function. So in general, this will be written as an integral in E3p over 2 pi. Let me normalize it in this way. Here I put psi of p. Okay. So psi of p is the wave function. It tells you it's the wave packet. And here I'm integrating over all p. Psi of p gives me the probability amplitude of the particle as momentum p. And this is the wave function of one particle state. I normalized the wave function with this prefactor here, so that if you compute the norm of psi psi, you indeed will get 1. If the integral in D3P of psi of p modulo square is normalized to 1. And this is because if you do the integral, if you rewrite this, you have two integrals, 2 pi cube or 2 omega, and then the one particle state with another particle state momentum p and q will give you 2 pi cube, 2 omega delta 3p. You integrate, you get this. So psi of p is indeed associated to the probability amplitude of finding that one particle state of momentum p, and that probability amplitude indeed is normalized to 1. Okay. This is just a one way back. Okay, so our state, we want to build a state with two particles. So let me build one. So our general two particle state is gonna be, let me call it psi A, psi B. So one wave function for the particle type A, one wave function for the particle B. So at times equal to minus infinity, they will be infinitely far from each other. So that I can write the general wave function as the product of the two wave functions. So this will be the integral d3p1, 2 pi to the 3 half, root 2 omega 1, d3p2, same the second momentum. Then I have the wave function for the particle A as a function of p1, the wave function for the particle B as a function of p2. And then I have the one particle, the two particle state, one will move into p1 and one will move into p2. This suffice, but I'm going to pull out now a factor from the following consideration. Let's assume that you have a particle A and a particle B, which will be colliding in the center of mass. But imagine you have a non-trivial impact factor, which means that the momenta of the two-way packets are not collinear, but they have an offset. And the offset I can actually indicate with a vector, b, which lives on the plane which is orthogonal to the momenta in the center of mass. Okay? This information about this offset can be factorized out by the wave function. It's in principle it's inside the wave function, right? Because what I'm saying is that there will be a wave function here for this particle, and a wave function there for the other wave function, and somehow this wave function are offset. So the information about this offset is contained inside this psi p1 and psi p2. I'm going to pull it out from them and put it in explicit. How? Well, the offset, it will look like this. It will look like e to the I v dot p1 minus p2. And now this psi of p1 and psi p2 have no offset. Why is this? Because to create an offset, imagine you start with a configuration without offset. To create an offset, what you have to do is to take one of the two states and translate it by this vector. But the translation operator is just is just a phase on the state, which is e to the I, the shift times the momentum, the relative momentum of the two plates. So this phase here is basically encodes an offset of an amount which is b between the two wave packets.
Can we just change the integration variable somehow so that this factor just becomes e to the power I b times only p2, not the difference of that?
You want to translate P1, for example. Yeah, maybe, but then, yeah, we'll have here translated a different way far.
There's an integration that you can change the variable for that.
Yeah, you can translate P2 and P1, but then you have to remember here you have to put also the argument will be different. Now, written in this way, the two psi are basically equivalent. Alright. So this is our, if you want, this is our initial state. And then what we need is to compute the number of scattering events, is now to associate the probability that when two particles scatter, they actually produce a scattering event. In principle, they could just fly through, but with some probability, they can lead to a non-trivial event, which will lead to a count of this type. So the probability that a non-trivial event happens, so the probability that some particular state in goes in another state out, we know very well, is basically the modulus square of the in-out S matrix element modulus square. This is the probability that a very particular state in goes into a particular state out. Now, because of the unitarity of this matrix, we know that if you sum over all possible out states, out S in modulus square, we must find one. And this is just because S's dagger is proportional to the identity. Is the identity, sorry, not proportional. right? Now, this state out could be any state, right? You have to sum over all states. Of course, not all the states will contribute here. The only state that will contribute are those that are compatible with the symmetries of the instate. Since the symmetry leads to conserved charges, you can only have non-trivial out states here, only if they have exactly the same energy as the instate, exactly the same total momentum, total angular momentum, and total charges. Okay? So you restrict a lot the number of possible states. Still, in general, you will have a continuum of out states. Just the constraint that they have the same energy and same momentum and so on will not completely fix the individual momentum of the external particles. And you will find a continuum of possible states that will contribute to this sum. So in this, indeed, this sum is not a sum, it's really an integral over all possible final states, which form a continuum. So the probability that you end up with a very particular state is actually infinitesimally small, because only after you integrate it over, you'll get a final result, one. So we can what this is I take an out state in an eigenstate of momenta, this is actually an infinitesimal probability, and this sum is actually an integral over all out state, which will lead to something fine. So this guy here, what form it has? Well, it has the following form. First of all, I'm going to consider out states that are different from in states. If the out state is exactly the same as the in state, then nothing happens. So this will give me the contribution from nothing happens. The two particles go through without interacting. But I'm only interested in the scattering events, the events where I see something happens. So I will consider only out state that are different from the in state. So remember, if you write the S matrix as 1 plus IT, what I'm saying is that I'm going to consider only T, because the identity that only contributes when the out state is equal to the in state, for me, is nothing happening. I want to only count the cases where something is happening. So I'm actually interested in the probability that something happens, which means that this will give me the matrix element of the T matrix between an out state and an in state. Now, because of this, this guy here can also be written as follows. S, so is the modulo square. Now I'm going to take a basis for the out state, for all possible state. The basis I'm going to consider is the basis of the Fock space, the basis of n particle state against state of the moment. Right? So let me take the generic state, is of the form one particle momentum p1, one particle momentum p2, one particle momentum pn, if I have n particle in the final state. Here I have t, here I have my in state, for example, that state, psi a, psi b, modulo square. And in here, in front, I will have what is called the phase space. I will have something that is the integral in d3p1 over 2 pi cube 2 omega 1 times d3p2 over 2 pi cube 2 omega 2 times d3pn over 2 pi cube 2 omega n times a factor k here. So this big factor here is called the phase space d phi n of n particles. And it's there. So first of all, it tells you that indeed you have an infinitesimal probability. These are all infinitesimals. And give you the right weight in order to recover one from here. So all we did basically is from this expression, we saw that this was nothing that S dagger S between in state. And inside here, we used the completeness relation, the identity, which we wrote as vacuum plus one particle state. And then, if you remember, when we wrote it the first time, we had this factor here, and then for n particle state, there will be this extra factor here. So that when you take this expression and you multiply by n state, you get the state itself. So these factors here, 2 pi cubed to omega 1, are such that when you multiply by n particle state, by the orthogonality of the states, you get the factor 2 pi cubed to omega delta, which remove this, and eventually you get 1.
Well, what about the factor k?
The factor k is there, and it counts as an extra 1 over n factorial in case you have identical particles. If you remember, in the normalization of 2 particle state, for example, we were getting something was 2 pi cubed, 2 omega, blah, 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 delta 3, and there was an extra factor of 2 in case this was identical particle, it was to contract this with this and this with that, or this with that and this with this. In case you have, in this final state here, n particles which are identical, then you have to, here you have to divide by 1 over n factorial to take this effect into account, because it's basically, otherwise you overcount states which are identical. So basically this expression here gives you the infinitesimal probability that this particular initial state will end up into a state with definite momentum p1 pn, and if you get basically infinitesimal weight for that infinitesimally small phase space. If you are interested in what is called the total cross-section, total probability that something happens, you have to integrate this over all possible particle state over all possible momenta. When you integrate this over all momenta, you basically have to integrate over this differential to get some finite probability. So you only get a finite probability if you ask a question about what is the probability that my state will end up with some interval of momenta, not with one particular momenta. The probability that goes with one particular momenta will always be zero. Okay? Only a finite interval. After all, any experiments can only will have an intrinsic uncertainty, will only be able to measure an interval of momentum. If you want, just by uncertainty principle, you will never be able to measure a momentum with arbitrary accuracy because it will require an experiment which is infinitely big. Okay, so this is the infinitesimal probability for this process. And now we're going to use it to relate this guy here. So this is the... right. So. So now I can say that the number of scattering events per unit particle type A is what? Well, you see, this is the probability that my particle A interacts with one particle B with some definite impact parameter. Let me pull an index B here, which basically tells me that this is a state with some non-trivial impact parameter B. So the probability, the number of scattering events must be basically the convolutions over all impact parameters. So I take one particle A, I interact with each of the particles of type B. Each of them will have some impact parameter B, small b. So I integrate over all impact parameters of the bunch. And for each of them, I have a probability amplitude, so a total probability that P in goes in P out, which is a function of the impact parameter B. And then this is a probability that one particle A interacts with one particle B with the impact parameter small b. And then I have to weight that probability by the density of particles of type B. With the density of particles of type B, that in general can be a function of the impact parameter. It can be a function of if I don't have a uniform distribution of particles in the bunch. So this is the unit probability for this state here, and I convoluted all possible impact parameters and the number of particles per unit length. Per unit area.
Why is it d squared? Why is d squared b? Why is
it squared? It's b-dimensional because b lives on the plane which is orthogonal to the momentum, is the impact parameter. So I'm integrating over the area. And this is the number of particles per unit area. So at the end, I have the total number of particles B. Each of them will have a particular probability to scatter with the particle A and give me a final state.
For NB, it's the number of particles sitting at the same distance. For fixed B.
Yes, because this PB, I'm using this initial state with a B here, which was defined this, which was at a fixed impact parameter B. So basically, let me draw it better. I take P fixed and I integrate over like a circle with B fixed. Right? Same B, and integrate over all of them. So this is, if I'm interested in a total number of scattering events, this is the formula, provided that I sum over all possible out state. If I'm interested in a particular out state, so if I'm interested in the number of scattering events with a particular final state, then here I have to put the probability for a particular out state. In particular, I can talk about, let me talk about this later. First, let me make a small approximation. Let me approximate NB to a constant in small b. Let me assume that this probability falls off fast enough, which means that the range of interactions is small enough that it only probes the number density of particle type B in an interval of B which is so small that NB can be considered constant in the distant B. So even if the distribution of this particle B is not homogeneous, the range of interaction is so small that over the range of interaction, this distribution looks homogeneous. If this is the case, then I can pull out NB from the integral. And now if I match this object with this object, I see that I can identify this integral with a cross section.
But in electromagnetic interaction, the range is short.
It's not short.
It's not short.
So in that case, this approximation is not correct. But most of the cases still works because the range of interaction is not short. The range of interaction is not small for charged particles. So if you take any material, the fact that it's neutral, it means that there is the range of interaction is constrained to the size of the atoms, which is still pretty small. So unless you have a gas of charged particle, you shouldn't worry about this.
I have another question. The fact that the out state is produced due to an interaction of the two particles and not to an independent decay of each of them, I guess it's encoded in the S matrix, because I use the interaction term. However, this is not completely true in the real experiment, because they may decay independently. And the
You're worrying now about
the out state may not be caused because of interaction of two particles, but maybe for decay of each of them independently. And how do I make sure that the scattering?
You're saying that this decay.
Yeah, maybe A and B decay. And cause another out state, which is not because of the scattering.
I'm assuming that now that A and B are stable.
Okay.
Because when I write in and out state, I should only put stable particles because they live at t equal to minus infinity, t equal to plus infinity. Of course, this might not be the actual situation in an experiment. You could consider, for example, the scattering of two muons. The muons in general can decay. So if everything happens at times much shorter than the decay time, this is a good approximation. In case it's not, then this is not a good framework to study that process. And you should actually go back and see what actually particle created this A and B, because if they have a finite lifetime, it means that cannot be live at t equal to minus infinity. It means that this is not the initial state. The initial state is the father of this particle. And then you compute the cross-section of the father of the particle that actually created them.
How do I know that? How do I know who was the father of these muons?
Well, if you know, you can compute. If you don't know your initial state, you can, because the answer will depend on that.
Yeah.
Because it depends on the lifetime. It depends on how well you know the initial condition. Of course, sometimes you have an initial condition and a finite time. I can tell you that at this time, I measure that I have two muons. Then in that case, you will not be able to use the S matrix, which is defined between minus infinity and plus infinity. You have to use the matrix of finite time, the unitary matrix of finite time, which is not Lorentz invariant. But with that, you can work out the answer. You just input your initial wave function and just compute the amplitude, probability amplitude in that case. It's a little bit more complicated. Anyway, for most cases, all the approximation I said, and I will say later, they work very well. Yeah? Typically, you are well within the approximation I made, so that the correction to those can be safely neglected. But I will tell you when you should be careful. Okay, so this is the total, what is called total cross-section. In the case, you consider basically this formula for all possible out state. Then you get the total number of scattering events. But what often it's more interesting to work on a more detailed quantity, which is the so-called differential cross-section, which is basically the cross-section associated to the infinitesimal probability that an in-state goes to a particular out-state. because now you can use this differential probability, differential cross-section, and integrate it over the range of states that you want to consider in the out state. For example, it may well happen that you can, in this experiment, for example, you can detect a particle from the scattering only within some angle, for example, or only if they have enough energy to come out. So you cannot consider total cross-section, because total cross-section also includes the possibility that a particle will scatter very close to the initial particle, or will scatter into a particle which is so little energetic that it escapes the detection. So those you cannot consider them. So you only want, you're interested in the scattering events that you can detect. So for this case, the differential cross-section is more useful, because then you can actually integrate over the range of momenta, angles, and so on, that your detector is actually sensitive to. And then you can compare actually with the experiment. But for us, this is good, because after all, this differential cross-section is related to the differential probability, which is exactly given by this formula here. So let me recap. Here, the important formula. So now I'm going to compute this guy here. So basically here I have to put in this expression here, and then integrate over D2P, and here the initial state, I have to substitute this expression there. So it's going to be a little bit length. So I have an integral in D2B from here. Then from the initial state I have two integrals, but notice that here there is initial state modulus squared, so we have four integrals for that. So I have integral in D3P1 over 2 pi to 3 half to omega 1 D3P2, same factors with the root 2 omega 2, D3P1 bar, D3P2 bar, similar factors, right?
You also have E1 there, so shouldn't you say the indication value there?
Sorry, you are right, let me call it. Let me keep P1 and P2, let me call this Q1, Qn, okay? Okay, so you have all those integrals. Then I have to copy. I have this modulus square. If you remember, when you compute this amplitude, this was the amplitude that you compute with Feynman diagrams, right? The probability amplitude for the process in to out of this matrix. This probability amplitude is always proportional to a total delta function of the form total initial momentum, let's say P in minus P out. The total final momentum is Q, let's say Q out. Okay, the total energy momentum conservation. And what was left was a probability amplitude we call N. This was actually what you compute with Feynman diagrams. So this is the probability, this is the scattering amplitude between the state AB and Q out. Okay. I have to take the modulo square of that. So you'll have two of this delta function and M in and out. So let me write those factors as, I write them down here. There will be M between the initial state P1, P2, that goes into Q out, times the modulo square, so there will be an M dagger, if you want, of the process now with momentum P1 bar, and P2 bar goes into Q out. We don't have exactly the same momenta because here the each of them will involve an integral over their own momenta. What else I have? I have the exponents. Let me go here, e to the I b. P 1 minus P 2. For M stars, I have the same. I have the wave functions. Psi of P1 for the particle A, psi of P2 for the particle B, psi star A of P1 bar, psi star B of P2 bar. And I have the phase space d phi n. So you see that there are a lot of integrals. 3, 6, 12, 14. As we will see, fortunately, there are simplification. And I forgot the delta function, more importantly. We have a 2 pi to the 4 delta 4 of P1 plus P2 minus Q dot for the first, and then we have another 2 pi to the 4, delta 4 of P1 bar plus P2 bar minus Q dot. So the integral in D to B is readily done, because B only appears in the exponents, and thus it will just give you a delta function for this momenta here. I guess I could have done after all the shifting momentum P1 and P2. Shouldn't matter, but
P1 should not.
Yeah, I could always go to the frame where P1 is 0, and then I have P2 and P2 bar. In any case, the integral in D2B, I can write it down, and it will give me a 2 pi square delta of, for example, if I go in the frame where P1 and P1 bar are 0, just give me a delta of P2 parallel minus P2 bar parallel. Parallel means that is in the direction of parallel to the scattering, orthogonal to the area of the two wave packets. Because B was orthogonal. B was orthogonal, so it will give a delta for the orthogonal components. It's a two-dimensional delta from the two B here. It will give a delta on the two direction of the omega P, which are orthogonal to the scattering. Okay, so now you see that we got two less integrals and two more deltas, which is good. So eventually we have 4, 8, 10 deltas and 3, 6, 12 integrals. So eventually we'll be left only with two integrals, which is the total freedom that you'll be left with. There are much more integrals actually than those. I hidden many more delta delta 3q, it depends how many final set is. So. Okay.
Why P1 and P1 bar don't appear in the...
I just went in the frame where P1 was P1 was parallel to B. So the P1 orthogonal is not is 0. So you remember there was a wave packet here, wave packet there, and I put the B here, and I said that I have a factor like this from the shift. Of course, the full problem is invariant on the translation in this direction. So I could choose always the frame where I put basically the zero here of coordinates, which means that this is one of the two is not there. Let's say this. And then B only measures the P2. So I only shift one with respect to the other. But just this is the total invariance and the translation. I could have left and have also two components there, then you use it later. Okay, so how to proceed? So let's consider to start these six integrals and these six deltas. Four plus two deltas here and six integrals in P1 bar and P2 bar there. Okay? Eventually, these deltas will completely fix P1 bar and P2 bar. This Q dot actually must match, because of the other delta, P1 plus P2. So here I can equivalently write minus P1 minus P2, using this other graph. And now if I do the integral in P1 bar and P2 bar, this tells me that the sum of P1 and P2 is equal to the sum of P1 and P2 bar, component by component, with four conditions. On top of that, P2 itself, orthogonal, must be equal to P2 bar orthogonal. And this will fix completely P1 and P2, which are inside here, because P1 and P2 eventually only have six independent parameters, because it must be on shell from this condition here. Then it means that P1 must be equal to P1 bar and P2 is equal to P2 bar. This is clearly a solution of this constraint. And with some work, you can show that it's the only one. Okay. So the delta imposes this. So eventually, we're going to replace P1 bar and P2 bar everywhere with P1 and P2, and remove this integral. But there are extra factors that come when you actually perform this delta, coming from the Jacobian, not the delta, the derivative of the delta with respect to the variable integration. Those we have to keep track. So let's do it here. So we have integral in d3p1 bar, d3p2 bar over. There is a 2 pi cube. So I'm just taking these factors here and this factor here. So there is a 2 pi cube, a root of 2 omega 1 bar, 2 omega 2 bar. Inside here, I have a 2 pi to the 6, delta 4, P1 plus P2 minus P1 bar minus P2 bar, delta 2, P2 orthogonal minus P2 bar orthogonal. Let me do one trick, two tricks. Okay, I can remove, for example, these three integrals are simple. The integrals over P2 bar, P1 bar. Let me do P1 bar. P1 bar, because P1 bar only appears here. So the delta 3 of the special component of this delta with the integral of the special component of P1 bar are trivial. And we get 2 pi cube, the integral over d3p2 bar, which is left, over 2 omega 1, 2 omega 2 in the root. Here I get only the delta of the zero component, but the zero component of this vector is like omega 1 bar plus omega 2 bar minus omega 1 minus omega 2. And here I have still the two delta of the orthogonal components of P2 and P2 bar.
Why is it 2 omega 2 and not 2 omega 2 bar in the square root?
Here?
Yes.
Because it should be omega. Well, this now is the same because it fits P1 plus P2, the other one is P1 plus P2. Now we can perform the integral over the P2 orthogonal. Let me do it here. So 2 pi cube. So if I do the integral with P2 bar orthogonal, I only left with the the integral of P2 bar, the component which is parallel, which is dP2 bar parallel. The root as before. The delta 2, I use it to make the integral of P2 orthogonal bar, which is equal to P2 bar orthogonal. And now I'm left with the delta of omega 1 bar plus omega 2 bar minus omega 1 minus omega 2. Okay?
The omega 1 bar inside the delta is necessary. Omega 1 bar is equal to omega 1.
One of the two omega maybe no, omega 1, you're saying?
Yeah.
Yes.
It's going to be cancelled inside it.
Yes. Yes. I'm confused. I brush too much. Let me, because yes, sorry, I was too fast. This omega 1 is not equal to omega 1 bar yet, because when I fixed P 1 bar, this fixed P1 bar to P1 plus P2 minus P2 bar. So it doesn't fix yet P1 bar equal to P1, but it fixes to a function of P2 bar. So inside this omega 1, omega 2, there's still a dependence on all the other pieces. Okay? So sorry. Just keep the omega 1 bar, omega 2 bar explicitly, because only eventually they will match. But I haven't finished all the integrals yet. So here there's still 2 omega 1 bar, 2 omega 2 bar. And here I have to keep all of them. So now I can perform the final integral using the final delta. This will match. Because of this, it will match all the P1 equal to P1 bar, P2 equal to P2 bar. But to be careful, because now the way P2 bar or parallel enters inside here is non-trivial. In particular, it will enter both here and here, because of the equation I wrote here. Okay? So let me write it. The first step was fixing P1 to bar to P1 bar to P1 plus P2 minus P2 bar, and then we fix P2 orthogonal bar to P2 orthogonal. Okay, this is what coming from the previous delta. Now in this delta here, so the result of this delta will be 2 pi cube, 1 over 2 omega 1, 2 omega 2 on the root. Now I fix all the p bars. But then we'll be left with a factor which is 1 over the derivative of this guy with respect to p2 parallel bar. So it's the derivative of omega 1 bar over P2 parallel plus the derivative of omega 2 bar over the P2 parallel. So let me write it as 2 pi cube root 2 omega 1, 2 omega 2, 1 over. Let's see. P, which one was? P2 bar parallel. Let's do first this. Omega 2 bar. Omega 2 bar is root of M2 square plus P2 bar square. So when you perform the derivative of omega 2 bar with respect to P2, each of these components, you get just the ratio of P2 parallel over omega 2. So this is also equal to 2 P2 parallel over omega 2. It's this factor here. What about this? Omega 1 over P2. But you see, if you perform a derivative of omega 1 with respect to P2, it's the same as taking minus the derivative with respect to P1, because P1 is related to P2 with a minus. So the derivative of omega, which one? Omega 1 bar over P2 parallel is equal to minus the derivative of omega 1 bar with respect to P1 bar parallel. Which is eventually minus P1 parallel over omega 1.
And this can be seen as the relative velocity. One this
dimension. So P2 parallel over omega 2 is indeed the velocity of the particle 2, and this is the velocity of particle 1, so you have the difference in velocity of the two particles. So this object can also be written as 2 pi cube over 2 omega 1, 2 omega 2, the modulus of delta v. So we were somewhere here. So now we are left with, let me rewrite now the whole expression as an integral in d3p1, d3p2, it was a factor of 2 pi cube. Here, root of 2 omega 1, root of 2 omega 2, but the same coefficient we get from here and here, so we get now 2 omega 1, 2 omega 2. There is a 2 pi cube from here, which actually removes this 2 pi cube here. Okay, then there is a delta v in modulus here. So I used all this. So what else I'm missing? Now you have this m stars, but p1 and p2 is equal to p1, p2 bar, so this is really modulus square of m from p1, p2 to q. And then I have these wave functions, factor. But now, since P1 is equal to P1 bar and P2 equal to P2 bar, these are the modulo squares of the wave function A and the modulo square of the wave function B. And I have a phase space of n particle state of the final. The final state, and still I have a delta function, which is 2 pi to the 4, delta 4 of P1 plus P2 minus Q dot. Now indeed it's much shorter. Now I'm going to make a further assumption. And the assumption is that despite the fact that the initial state were organized in a wave function of the momenta, I'm going to assume that the initial state is well localized in momentum. So the wave function of the initial state, the wave packets, are almost eigenstates of the moment. So they are described by functions which are highly peaked. Well, as a function of P1 and P2 are highly peaked around a value, in this case PA, which I call the momentum of the incoming particle type A, and similar for me. If this is true, then this integral in P1 and P2 will be highly peaked around the value PA. So if the rest of the integrand is a smooth function of P1 and P2, then I can well approximate this smooth function to a constant, which is the value of that function at PA and PB, and factor all that factor outside the integral, and I will be left with the integral in d3p1, d3p2 of psi of p1 and psi of p2 modulo squared, which are normalized to 1. So in the case where the wave function is localized in momentum on an interval in delta p over which the amplitude is smooth, is approximately constant, then this expression further simplifies into this factor, which is 1 over 4 omega 1 omega 2 modulus of delta v. Now this is omega 1 omega 2 will be omega a and omega b, and this is delta b a b. The modulus of the amplitude square between the momenta PA and PB that goes in Q dot times the factor 2 pi to the 4 delta 4 PA plus PB minus Q dot times the phase space factor of the particle state. And this is the final expression for our differential cross section d sigma into a particular final state described by this momenta and the quantum numbers of the particle involved in this one.
Take all of this outside the integral. You said that if the rest of the integrand is the smooth function,
yes,
then we can take it outside the integral.
Yes.
But the delta function is not a smooth function.
Which one?
What is delta function?
The amplitude.
Yeah. The The delta function is a smooth function in P1 and P2.
In terms of distribution, it is smooth. Because it gives the every slight function.
You see, you have an integral in d3p1 and d3p2, and you have a lot of integral in qn. So the delta function can be used to fix the phase space q1 qn as a function of p1 p2. After you do that, the phase space will be a smooth function p1 p2 without delta functions. And then you'll have fact that this is what I will do afterwards.
Yeah. One time I came across one of the reasoning which said that we can approximate the P1 plus P2 in the delta function by PA plus PB because the real detectors have finite resolution. So they cannot detect very, very small changes.
This is in the first part, not in the delta. It was in the delta, it will always be there because it's conservation of moment. So you will not smoothen this delta. What is smoothen is this guy here.
Since the real particles have finite resolution, so we can replace this P2 in the delta function with PA plus PB because the real detectors are not very good at differentiating between very small change in moment.
Yes. It's related to what I was saying. So here you have to integrate over Q1, mm-hmm. Q2, Qn. Mm-hmm. Now, you cannot be in an eigenstate of Q1, Qn because of the argument you just said. So, which automatically produce, after integrate over Qs, a smooth function of P1 and P2. But if you were interested in final state with the eigenstate of Q1, Qn,
then it
will not be a smooth function of Q1.
We could also consider that the delta function is the limit of a smooth function, just like the Gaussian. So we can perform the first integration, then make the limit.
Here there is an integration if you integrate over Q1, Qn. But now if I'm saying that, I want the final state to be an eigenstate of the momenta, Q1, Qn, then it's like having extra delta functions.
Actually, what he's saying is that we can represent delta functions as a limit to a sequence of smooth functions.
Yes.
So if we replace delta function by that, then since it would be a smooth function, then we can take it out of the integral.
Yeah.
But then the result would depend on the representation of the delta function itself. That's the problem.
It's not automatic that the limits commute. The limits where you take this to be very thin, and the limits where you take the delta.
But usually the parameter is independent of the input.
If you multiply smooth function. If you multiply two deltas, between them, the result is ambiguous. Yeah. Only when you multiply a delta to a smooth function, then the result is unambiguous of the limit when you define a delta function. If you take two distribution and you multiply between them, the result is ambiguous. It depends how you make the limit to define the distribution. Okay. So this is our final expression for the differential cross section. You can see following thing is that this phase space integral is Lorentz invariant. You remember it's the T3Q over 2 omega Q. You have a delta function which is manifestly Lorentz invariant. The scattering amplitude is Lorentz invariant. Because if you remember, we constructed from the S matrix, which was Lorentz invariant. This factor here doesn't look Lorentz invariant. In fact, it's not.
But it's invariant to the boosts in the parallel
direction. Yes, it's, let's see how it's not Lorentz invariant. So what is this? This was omega A, omega B times the velocity, which was P B over omega B minus P A over omega A. So this is nothing else that omega A P B minus omega B P A. So this is the parallel moment. Okay? This guy here I can also write as epsilon I J mu nu P A mu P B nu, where I J are two direction orthogonal to A B. So because if you take I and J orthogonal, you'll be left either with a time component or with a parallel component, anti-symmetrized, which gives you exactly this product here. So now, written in these terms, you see that this guy is not Lorentz invariant, because indeed he has an explicit indices which are not in, in some direction, which are the orthogonal ones. But he transforms S an object with two indices, special indices, in the direction which are orthogonal. So it transforms exactly as anti-symmetric. So it transforms exactly as the area element sigma ij orthogonal to the scattering. So this transforms exactly like an area which is orthogonal to the scattering will transform under Lorentz transformation. You will be completely Lorentz invariants under boosts and translations and under the parallel directions. But it will contract if you boost it orthogonal to it. But this is compatible with our initial formula here, because you see that the number of scattering events, if you do a scattering between particle A and B, must be invariant and Lorentz invariant. So if I take an observer which is boosted under this experiment, you will still see the same number of particles coming out, just from different directions. So the number of scattering events is invariant, but if you remember in our computation, what was this? This was the number of particles B over an area. So the number of particles also is invariant under change of frame, but the area is not. So the cross-section must transform exactly like an area, so that to compensate the change of this area, so that the final result is Lorentz invariant. So this, the cross-section is not an invariant, but it transforms like an area, so that the final result, like the number of scattering events, is indeed Lorentz invariant. Maybe I can write it here. In the center of mass frame, you can rewrite this formula here, which involves the velocity explicitly, because in the center of mass frame, if you want, PA and PB will be by definition the same. So this guy here becomes, okay, from here, PB will be exactly the same as PR with the opposite sign. So this product here is also equal to the momentum of either A or B in modulus, which are the same in the center of mass, times the sum of the energies of each of the two particles colliding. In the center of mass frame, this is also equal to what is called the square root of S, where S is the Lorentz invariant product of PA plus PB squared. In the center of mass frame, PA plus PB only have the time component, which is exactly omega A plus omega B, so root S is omega A plus omega B. So in that frame, in the center of mass frame, this formula simplifies to, well, or can be rewritten as the modulus of the momenta of one of the two particles times the root S, the total energy in the center of mass frame. So okay, so these are the kinematical data of the scattering. All the information about the dynamics, interactions, and momentum dependence of the final state are encoded here. So here is the meat of the amplitude of the process. And then this is just the kinematical factor, which is the phase space of the final particle state, with a constraint that is given by the energy momentum conservation. So, of course, if there are many particles, this might easily become very hard to compute explicitly. For a simple case where the final state is only two particle state, can be very conveniently worked out. So if you have a two particles in the final state, so your process is A and B that goes into Q1 and Q2. This final factor here is just, so d phi n, d phi 2 in this case, times 2 pi to the 4 delta function, will just be D3 Q1 D3 Q2 Delta 4 PA plus PB, let's say P top minus Q1 minus Q2. Now, as you see, here you have six differentials, four deltas, which means that the final freedom in the final state just from energy momentum conservation is constrained to two variables, and these two variables are just the angles of the scattering. So if you have, for example, in a center mass frame, if you have two particles A and B colliding, the final momenta will come out in the center of mass frame with total zero momentum. The total energy is constrained by the process from the initial energy momentum. The total momentum is zero. The final freedom is just the two angles. Phi and theta from which they can come out. And this you can see by just solving this delta function here. So one way to solve it simply is the following. You just take one of the two differentials, and as you, if you remember, you can always write this as a d4q over 2 pi to the 4 times a delta of q squared minus m2 squared. And a theta of q2 naught. Remember? The delta function of the on-shell condition was fixing q0 to be 1, the integral would be 1 over 2 omega, and then there was an extra 2 pi. And now that you have this, you can simply integrate the delta 4 and remove the integral in d4, 2 pi to the 4 and 2 pi to the 4, and you're left basically with d3 q1 over 2 pi squared 2 omega 1 times the constraint that coming from the delta 4 that Q2 must be equal to V dot minus Q1. Times a delta function of Q2 squared minus F2. Now, since Q2 is equal to this, this delta function is actually equal to d dot minus Q1 squared minus M2 squared. And this will fix also the modulus of Q1, with which you remove the integral over the modulus of Q1, you will be left with just the two integral over the angles of Q1. So you can compute the full result is Lorentz invariant. So you can actually compute this in any frame you want. For example, the center of mass frame is particularly simple. And if you now perform the last integral, you will find this will be just integral in the modulus of Q, Q1 modulus squared, and then there will be the angular differential of the two angles. And here Q1 is fixed if you write it all in components. So at the end, if you perform all the steps, you will find that this guy will be equal to d omega over 4 pi squared, Q1 in modulus over root S, which is the total energy in the center of mass. So if you have the 2-to-2 scattering, the only dependence on the final state momenta that you can have is just a dependence over the angular distribution of the process. So after imposing energy momentum conservation, also this amplitude, in the case of 2-to-2 scattering, will only depend on theta and phi, mostly theta. And so all the dynamics will just give you that. Okay? Because all the modulus, all the energy momentum conservation fix the moduli and the of the moment and the total energy. So if you combine this with this, for the total scattering, you can write what is called the differential cross section, the 222 in the center of mass frame, which is just 1 over 4 pi square, Q1 over PA. So this is the modulus of the final particles, this is the modulus of the moment of the incoming particle, when in the center of mass frame are the same, Q1 is equal to Q2 and P1 is equal to B. And then you just have the modulus square of the amplitude over 4 times the energy with the total energy in the center of mass frame. Come from a root s from here and a root s from there. So this is now the short formula for this. So this gives you basically, it will give you the number of events that you will get in a unit solid angle that you fix from this scattering amplitude. If you want the total cross-section, you just have to integrate this expression over all 4 pi angles.
If the incoming two particles and the outgoing two particles, if all of them have the same mass, then this momentum factor just becomes one?
Yes. Yes, this is will be nothing else than the square root of the energy minus the mass 1, the square root of the energy. Since the energy is the same, then questions? So now, in principle, you can use this formula to compare between experiments, the number of counts in the experiment with the particular, for example, in the 222 case, with the particular angle, solid angles, and a particular type of particles, and compare with the calculation that you get using this formula and the scattering amplitude that you will compute to the Feynman diagrams as we sketched last time.
And that particular formula in which you calculated d sigma in the center of mass frame, can we modify that formula, the Box formula,
on
your
this
right?
Or that?
On your right.
This one?
Box formula. Box.
This, yeah, one.
So can we change the pre-kinematical factor to obtain an expression for the decay rate?
I will talk. Not next time, but another time about the decay rate. Mm-hmm. You will see that there is a complication when you perform exactly the same steps we did. Of course, it's a little bit simpler because the initial state is only one particle, there are much less integrals. But you'll find that there are more delta functions than integrals. You'll find the delta of zero, which is infinite. And that is associated to the problem that your initial state is not an asymptotic state. You can modify a little bit so that you can still get the rate with an equivalent formula.
Well, we can assume that the particles came into existence by scattering of two particles which were from the electrode.
Or, yeah, this is one way, or the other way is to actually, yes, which is a correct way, to put also the fathers of that particles in.
Father and mother.
and associate the actual particle rate to the full process. I will discuss these two things. So tomorrow I'll give you an example. We'll show you example explicitly of some particular process, how to compute also this part explicitly. We'll see the full cross sections of function of the coupling and the